Hello and welcome to this Open Embedded and Yocto project talk that will present best practices. So first, I'm Alexandre Belloni. I'm working as an embedded Linux engineer at Bootlin, where we do mostly development, consulting, and we also provide trainings. We are completely focused on Linux itself and mostly the kernel, but we do also some bootloaders and build system work, so we are quite often used to integrate whatever we develop inside either Yocto project or buildroot. So I'm also the maintainer for the Linux kernel RTC subsystem, and I'm the co-maintainer for the kernel support for different families of microchips SoCs. So first, let's talk about distributions. First, I want to define what we are actually talking about, and so for example, you see there that Yocto project is not actually some code that you can use. It's actually an entity that is composed from multiple member companies, and they are working on different projects or code repositories, right? So the first, the main one, let's say, is Pocky, and Pocky is the distribution. And this is actually what you can use to build your root file system or your embedded project. So Pocky is the distribution, and it's composed of Open Embedded Core and Bitbake, and then a few other layers that are MetaPocky and MetaYoctoBSP. So Pocky is a reference distribution. It is not really tailored to your embedded system. And for example, it will always include OpenGL, even if your SoC doesn't have a GPU. So not only you will waste time building OpenGL support, but also you may generate an image that will not actually work for your platform. So it can definitely generate demo images, and it can be a good starting point to know whether you can actually flash a platform, or if you want to quickly show something working on your platform. But well, it's not really meant to be used as is on production systems. Also, you have to remember that the included features are not stable, and it's not that they are not reliable. What I mean is really that the number of features or the kind of features will change. And one of the examples I have there is that it switched from Xorg to Wayland a while ago, and that may be breaking whatever you were doing by using Pocky. And like I was saying, Pocky is just bundling Open Embedded Core, Bitbake, and two very, very small layers. So one of those layers is MetaYoctoBSP, and it is a BSP layer that is adding support for reference boards from the Yocto project members. And also you have MetaPocky, that is the actual distro layer that provides for different distribution. So that will be Pocky, Pocky Tiny, Pocky Bleeding, and Pocky AlCFG. So I'm not saying that the Yocto project is not doing a lot of work, because they are actually doing a lot of work, but the bulk of the work is not actually in the MetaYoctoBSP or MetaPocky layers, and more likely they will be improving Open Embedded Core and Bitbake. So for your project, I will say that not using Poki has some advantages. I will even say that it has many advantages. So when reporting bugs, for example, it will most likely be necessary to reproduce with a no distro build, that is, without using any distribution. And that's a way to ensure that it is not the distribution that is creating the bugs or issues you are seeing. It is also easier to start from a no distro and create a distribution rather than tuning a distribution that is starting from poki.conf, because as I was saying, Poki is trying to include a lot of features and enable a lot of features so that the build testing will be able to compile as much as possible. And so most of your tuning will be removing features from poki.conf. And it's way easier to add features than remove features. It is also easier to work with the Open Embedded Core repository when you want to send patch upstreams. The main reason is that then you have the actual commit hashes, because the Poki repository is combining the Open Embedded Core repository with their with the other layer directories, repositories, so the commit hashes will differ there. And also, well, one of the advantage will be confidentiality, because Poki is defining the pre-mirrors variable, and that variable will point to downloads.yoctoproject.org, and meaning that it will leak the name of everything that you are building that is fetched using version control. So anything that is fetched over Subversion, Git, Mercurial, and well, other version control. The main drawback that you will have there is that you will have to match Open Embedded Core and Bitbake. So for Open Embedded Core, you will have the usual Open Embedded branches name, so that will be, for example, Dunfell. And for Bitbake, you will have branches with a version number, and so you will have to match them. So, what I really recommend there is that you will want to create your own distribution, and it's not actually that difficult. You simply have to create one configuration file, and that configuration file will be in conf/distro in your own layer, usually depending on the size of the project. Usually what you will do is simply include the distribution configuration inside your BSP layer, but you may also want to create one layer with your distribution separately from your BSP layer. So inside that configuration file, you will define whatever policies that are distribution-wide. So that will be the toolchain selection, and that toolchain selection will include the libc selection. That's also where you will want to select init, so system 5 or system D. You will set the distro features variable. You may set a few preferred providers, for example, for the libjpg. And you also want to set package classes there. So package classes will say what kind of packages do you want to build for that particular distribution. Which is also, for example, one of the differences between Poki and Open Embedded core because the default for OpenOrbit core and a node distro build will be IPK, and the default for Pocky is RPM. Something also that you may want to set in your distribution configuration will be the QA checks that you want to do, and if you want to switch some warnings to errors, or create new warnings or new errors or new QA checks. That's also where you will do that. So something else I want to talk about will be local.conf, and I want to say that local.conf is really for your local configuration. So that will be, for example, the CPU number of your current building machine, or the disk space, how you want to react when the disk space is low. And for example, if you want to remove the work directory or that kind of things, really anything that is really local to your machine and that does not affect the output of the build. The main reason is that the distribution of the changes that are made in local.conf is not easy, because that file is really a configuration file that should only live on your machine, and you should not care about distributing that file or putting it in version control. So you don't want to affect the reproducibility of the build with the variables that you are putting in that file or defining that file. So there is also a huge drawback, is that when you change something in local.conf, Bitbake will parse all the recipes again, which will take like let's say 1 to 2, 3 minutes every time, which can be kind of annoying after some time. I will say that it is fine to carry changes in local.conf for development testing. It's not an issue as long as you then move those to the proper location when you are done with your development and testing. Something that I really want you to do is to avoid the numerous tutorials that are saying that you can do those changes in local.conf. So I will have some examples. One of the things you can do is that instead of putting variables in local.conf, you can have them in site.conf, which will be used for site-wide configuration. And that's where you will set up the company proxies, mirrors, the shared estate cache location, that kind of thing. So anything that will affect all the build machine inside your infrastructure. Unfortunately, that file kind of suffers from the same local.conf distribution drawback, meaning that it's not that easy to provide a site.conf and ensure that it will remain synced with the sources, the other sources from your layer. So the other location where you will put variables that you are changing in local.conf will be inside an image recipe, and it's actually the most abused variable that is put in local.conf, and that image install happened. And that's definitely what you can see in tutorials from many system on modules vendors, and well, it's working, but it's not really something you want to do. And well, it's not even easy for beginners to understand why they have to add that underscore append keyword after image install, and that's mainly due to the parse order, because that's, well, you can't use plus equals there. because your image recipe is parsed after local.conf. Well, also the solution to that is simply to create your own image recipe as soon as the core image something, so core image minimal or core image sato recipes are not enough anymore. So, and it's again, it's not that difficult. It's mainly inheriting from image base and then setting the image install variable or the image features variable. So it's not that difficult to create your own image recipe. All the machine-related variables have to go in the machine configuration, and that's also something you can see some people are putting in local.conf. It's the preferred provider virtual kernel, preferred provider virtual bootloader, and the preferred version for those. So that would be preferred version Linux something, preferred version U-boot, or those kind of variables. Something also will be the image FS types. So you could argue that image FS types should go inside the image recipe, but I would say that it kind of depends on your platform, because maybe your platform has a specific image type requirement depending on, I don't know, whether it has EMMC or NAND, and then you may want to select different image FS types depending on your actual machine and not depending on the image that is generated. In a few cases, you may also have some image install append in a machine configuration. And that is, for example, to install the kernel in the root file system, because that's where, in that case, the bootloader will look for it. So I will do that in, again, I will do that in the machine configuration as opposed to the image recipe, because depending on the machine, maybe the bootloader will look for the kernel inside the root file system, or maybe it will look for it in a separate row partition, or maybe a FAT partition, or that kind of thing. So again, I would prefer to have it in a machine configuration, because it's actually depending on the machine. Then you have the distribution configuration itself, and so that's where all the other variables should go, and that's where the remaining preferred provider and preferred version will definitely go. That's also where you will define the package config for packages. So package config allows you to define what kind of features you want for a particular package, and so this is definitely something that should go into your distribution configuration. And you will also want to set what kind of license is incompatible with what you want to provide, and what kind of license you want to whitelist. So if you want to whitelist any commercial license, I will do that in the distribution configuration. That's kind of also where I would put anything that you could also have in the site .conf, because, well, the distribution configuration is easy to distribute. It is part of your layer, and so well, for the ease of distribution and version control, I will move, for example, premirrors or proxies configuration inside the distribution configuration. So release management, there are multiple tasks that OpenOMED or BitBake based project will let you do on your own to ensure the build reproducibility. And the fact is that using BitBake, you will be able to generate reproducible images, but you have to get those layers first. So that's the main thing you have to do first. So that's the first step. There is to actually fetch Open Embedded Core, BitBake, your layers, set that up. Create your local.conf, bblayers.conf, and everything there. And so that's up to you to do that. And also something else is that the release tagging, it's up to you to select your own strategy there. So usually you will not do that manually every time, and you will use a separate tool. The usual solutions will be combo layer. That's what Poki is doing. So combo layer is the tool that is used to generate the Poki repository, and again the inputs are OpenEmbedded Core, BitBake, and those two MetaYocto-BSP and MetaPoki layers. And so using combo layers, they are combining all those repositories or part of those repositories inside a single repository. So that's also something you can do. You have some documentation on the Yocto project wiki, and you have a link to that there. What you would kind of not so often see will be the use of Git submodules, and if you have a look at the combo layer documentation, it will explain why you shouldn't do that. But I would say that's still something you can do. And so usually you don't have just the Git submodules, you usually also have a setup script there. And you have a great example in Yoi distro. So just have a look at what they are doing. You will see that it's mostly the setup scripts, and that setup script is setting up the submodules for you. So that's that's a nice way of doing things. On my side, I am mostly using repo, and that's because I was first working on Android, and so repo is an Android tool, and so I'm kind of used to it. So I'm using repo. You can use repo with template.conf or a setup script. You have an example in Meta Freescale, so that's how I started, and I'm now used to that, so that's what I'm using, and I will have an example of repo later. You also have CAS, which is fairly recent. It's I think from 2017, and CAS is a dedicated tool for Open Embedded, and really it's making your life really easier. And I'm not using it that much yet, but really that's definitely what I will be using from now on, because it's really convenient. So like I was saying, repo is used in Android to distribute the its source code, and the source code of Android is split in many Git repositories, and it's actually then basically the main use case that we have here, where we have layers in different Git repositories and we want to fetch them and put them at a single location so that they are available. to be used. So the repo configuration itself is stored in a manifest file, and that manifest file is usually in its own Git repository. That's what Freescale is doing, that's what Android is doing, but right now I've been used to also simply put that in a specific branch of my custom layer, and that just allows me to have one less Git repository to take care of. So it's kind of not obvious at first, but well, you can have a Git repository with kind of two different projects, your actual layer there, and then in a separate branch inside that same repository, you will get your manifest file. So repo will only handle fetching the code, and local.conf and bblayers.conf will have to be handled manually. So the manifest example is there, so you can see basically you will define some default values. In that case, the default value for the revision will be Dunfel, so that then if you are not defining the revision for a particular project, the Dunfel branch will be fetched. And then you define your remotes. There we have three different remotes, one for Open Embedded, one for Freescale, one for our own server. And finally, you define your project, so what you want to actually fetch and where you want to put them. So first project will be the remote that will be used will be the Freescale one, and we will fetch a project that is named MetaFreescale, and it will be located in sources/MetaFreescale. Then we fetch OpenOrbit core, and then we fetch Bitbake. So for Bitbake, as you can see, its path is inside the Open Embedded Core path, and that's definitely where Open Embedded Core will look for Bitbake. Then we have Meta Open Embedded there, and finally we use our own private server to download the our custom layer. In that case, it is named Meta Custom, and as you can see, for that particular project we have a copy file entry, and that entry will say, okay, I want to take something from SRC and put it in dest. So in that case, it will take build.conf setup environment from inside the Meta Custom layer, and it will put that in setup environment in the root of where you are running repo. So that's a way to distribute your setup scripts, right? And that setup script will usually set up the Bitbake environment, so it will most likely source OE init env, but it will also set up local.conf and bblayers.conf if they don't exist yet. Again, you have an example with what Freescale is doing, so I will let you have a look at that. To tag a release, a few steps have to be taken, so you will optionally tag your custom layers. It is really an optional step, you don't have to do that, but what you have to do is for each project entry in your manifest, you will want to set the revision parameter to either a tag if it exists, or a single commit hash, and finally you commit and tag this version of the manifest, and so it will ensure that basically everything that will be fetched will always be at that particular revision, and that ensures that Well, from a release point of view, your tagged manifest will always download the same sources. So you also have CAS. CAS is then the specific tool developed by Siemens for OpenEmbedded. You have a link there to the GitHub repository, and CAS will fetch layers and build the image in a single command. So that's really nice. It's even nicer than repo in that sense, because then repo is not specific to OpenEmbedded and Bitbake, but CAS is. So you can use a single configuration file that can be either JSON or YAML, and usually it will be part of the custom layer. So from the beginning, it is designed to be distributed with the custom layer. Something to note too is that it can generate and run inside a Docker container, which is really convenient, because then you don't even have to set up your own Docker container. It will do that for you, which will lower the risks of host contamination of your build. It will be able to set up the local.conf and bblayers.conf automatically from what is inside the configuration file, which is really important. So the CAS configuration looks like that. So you have a small header defining the version in case of where you will be updating CAS, just to know. So then you define your machine that will become the machine variable inside your local.conf. You can define your distro that will be the distro variable in local.conf. You can define a list of targets that will be the targets that will be passed to Bitbake. So usually it will be a single image target, but it can be multiple packages targets or whatever there. It's not an issue. And finally, you will define a few repositories. So in that case, you will use a meta custom. You don't define the URL, because meta custom is the first layer that you will download to actually get that particular configuration. And CAS will be smart enough to know that. Then you want to download Bitbake and OpenEmbedded Core. So you have the definition there. And if you see for OpenEmbedded Core, you have a layers variable that is a list of layers. And under that, you have meta. And meta is the single layer of OpenEmbedded Core. And that will instruct CAS to add the path to that meta layer to bblayers.conf. So the same for meta freescale. So you pass the URL to that layer, the branch you want to download, and then you have meta open embedded, and in that case, meta open embedded, you will get three different layers from meta open embedded, which are meta OE, meta Python, and meta networking. So it's really nice, because then it allows you to CAS will generate automatically bblayers.conf for you. Something you can see there is that, so you have a ref spec, and it's kind of the same as the revision from the repo manifest. Once you are ready to release, you just have to switch that ref spec to a single commit hash or a tag, and then tag your own layer, and that will tag that particular configuration file, and meaning that then you will always download the same sources from that particular configuration file. So something else you want to do when doing your final release is that you definitely want to ensure that all the code is already available internally. And that will be either on your local build machine, or at least on local internal mirrors, right? Because if you want to ensure reproducibility, you don't want to depend on external servers to be there or sources to be hosted somewhere you don't know. So the first step will be to ensure that you don't have any SRC rev equal autorev in any recipe. And then you want to generate the mirror tarballs for everything that is coming from Git repositories or version control. And so for that, you want to set the bb generate mirror tarballs variable. And that will generate the tarballs in DLDR for you. You fetch all the sources, so either you bitbake your target completely, or you just do bitbake-c fetch all target. So that will fetch all the sources that are necessary to build that particular target. Then you can archive DLDR and make those tarballs available internally. So if you only care about the local machine, you just have to keep that DLDR, but if you want to provide the tarballs as a mirror, then you will have to make them available, let's say on an HTTP server or something. So optionally, you can build once with bb-nonetworks set to 1 that will check for missing tarball, but at that point you shouldn't have any missing tarball, but more importantly, it will check for the remaining autorev that you can have in any recipe. Finally, you want to point bitbake to your own internal mirrors, and you can do that using premirrors, or you can use the own mirror class and set the source mirror URL. So I will let you have a look at those variables, but in the documentation, but it's easy to use them. And final step will be to build the actual release from scratch using bbfetch premirror only to ensure that bitbake will not be allowed to go to the external network, but only use the premirrors that you have set. So that should be your internal mirrors. So build optimization. You can share this state cache, which is then sharing the shared state cache. You can share it across multiple build machines, and usually the steps to do that will be to first set up continuous integration or nightly builds. Then you use a DLDR from those build machines to populate the premirrors. And finally, you will share the estate cache. So the estate cache is located in the estate dir. And you share it over NFS or HTTP. Usually it's fine to use HTTP because you definitely want that to be read-only and not then populated by whatever machine that is on your network. Finally, on your local machine, then you will set up the estate mirrors to point to that particular share, and meaning that your build machine will then fetch any state cache or state objects artifact from the mirror. That should speed up your build quite a lot, especially if you have a fast network, which is usually the case. And this only works well if all the hosts are similar enough, and usually meaning that they have the exact same distribution, running the exact same distribution and distribution version. Because your host will have influence over some estate cache signatures or checksums. So something that can help there will be the containers, and that's why I was saying that using CAS is really nice, because it will generate those containers for you. You can also want to clean that estate cache because it will only grow over time and nothing is removing any artifacts there. And so you may want to clean all data using the estate cache management script. Also, one of the topics that is quite important is license compliance. Something that is nice that Open Embedded will generate a license manifest for you. And it will list all the software that is present on the target image. And that will be in the license directory, so usually it will be in TMP deploy license, then the image name, and then license.manifest. So you have an excerpt there of that manifest. So it takes back the package name, its version, from which recipe it is coming from, and the license that is used. So that will help you in your license compliance efforts. For some licenses, you have to provide the license text. And to do that, you have two different ways. You can select to copy all the licenses inside your image root file system. So you can do that with copy leak dirs and copy leak manifest. That will copy the license directories and the license manifest inside your root file system. But then if you are using package management on the target, you will have no way to add new licenses. Or the other solution will be to use license create package, set that to one, and that will ask Bitbake to also generate the packages that are including only the license. And so then you can install the required license packages if you need the license to be installed, which is finer grained, but a bit more difficult to set up. You will also, for some licenses, you will also have to provide sources, and Open Embedded provides the archiver class to generate tarballs of the source code that is compiled. So you will want to use it with inherit plus equal archiver, so you put that in your local.conf, for example. And then you want to set up the archiver mode variable, and the default is to provide the patched source, which may not be enough. And if you want to provide the configured source, you can use the archiver mode src equal configured, and then it will provide it will create a tarball of the configured sources. Depending on how your lawyer is interpreting some licenses, you may decide that providing the compilation script is also necessary, and you also have a mode to do that. So have a look at the documentation for archiver mode to know how to do that. So that was it. I'm happy to take other suggestions, and if you have other best practices, or if you are wondering whether what you are doing is fine, just ask. Thank you for attending.